Scholastic Audio presents The Scorpio Races by Maggie Stiefvater, read by Steve West as Sean and Fiona Hardingham as Puck. Prologue. 9 years earlier. Sean. It is the first day of November, and so, today, someone will die. Even under the brightest sun, the frigid autumn sea is all the colours of the night, dark blue and black and brown. I watch the ever-changing patterns in the sand as it's pummeled by countless hooves. They run the horses on the beach, a pale road between the black water and the chalk cliffs. It is never safe, but it's never so dangerous as today, race day. This time of year, I live and breathe the beach. My cheeks feel raw with the wind throwing sand against them. My thighs sting from the friction of the saddle. My arms ache from holding up 2,000 pounds of horse. I have forgotten what it is like to be warm, and what a full night's sleep feels like, and what my name sounds like spoken instead of shouted across yards of sand. I am so, so alive. As I head down to the cliffs with my father, one of the race officials stops me. He says,
"Sean Kendrick, you are 10 years old. You haven't discovered it yet, but there are more interesting ways to die than on this beach."
My father doubles back and takes the official's upper arm as if the man were a restless horse. They share a brief exchange about age restrictions during the race. My father wins.
"If your son is killed," the official says, "the only fault is yours."
My father doesn't even answer him, just leads his Ishka stallion away. On the way down to the water, we're jostled and pushed by men and by horses. I slide beneath one horse as it rears up, its rider jerked at the end of the lead. Unharmed, I find myself facing the sea, surrounded on all sides by the Kapil Ishka, the water horses. They are every colour of the pebbles on the beach: black, red, golden, white, ivory, grey, blue. Men hang the bridles with red tassels and daisies to lessen the danger of the dark November sea, but I wouldn't trust a handful of petals to save my life. Last year, a water horse trailing flowers and bells tore a man's arm half from his body. These are not ordinary horses. Drape them with charms, hide them from the sea, but today, on the beach, do not turn your back. Some of the horses have lathered. Froth drips down their lips and chests, looking like seafoam, hiding the teeth that will tear into men later. They are beautiful and deadly, loving us and hating us. My father sends me off to get his saddlecloth and armband from another set of officials. The color of the cloth is meant to allow the spectators far up on the cliffs to identify my father, but in his case, they won't need it. Not with his stallion's brilliant red coat.
"Ah, Kendrick," the officials say,
which is both my father's name and mine.
"It'll be a red cloth for him."
As I return to my father, I am hailed by a rider.
"Ho, Sean Kendrick!"
He's diminutive and wiry, his face carved out of rock.
"Fine day for it."
I am honored to be greeted like an adult, like I belong here. We nod to each other before he turns back to his horse to finish saddling up. His small racing saddle is hand-tooled, and as he lifts the flap to give the girth a final tug, I see words burned into the leather: "Our dead drink the sea." My heart is jerking in my chest as I hand the cloth to my father. He seems unsettled as well, and I wish I was riding, not him. Myself, I am sure of. The red Ishka stallion is restless and snorting, ears pricked, eager. He is very hot today. He will be fast. Fast and difficult to hold. My father gives me the reins so that he can saddle the water horse with the red cloth. I lick my teeth, they taste like salt, and watch my father tie the matching armband around his upper arm. Every year I have watched him, and every year he has tied it with a steady hand, but not this year. His fingers are clumsy, and I know he is afraid of the red stallion. I have ridden him, this Capel, on his back, the wind beating me, the ground jarring me, the sea spraying our legs, we never tire. I lean close to the stallion's ear and trace a counterclockwise circle above his eye as I whisper into his soft ear. Sean! My father snaps, and the Capel's head jerks up quickly enough that his skull nearly strikes mine.
What are you doing with your face next to his today? Does he not look hungry to you? Do you think you'd look fine with half a face?
But I just look at the stallion's square pupil, and he looks back, his head turned slightly away from me. I hope he's remembering what I told him. Do not eat my father. My father makes a noise in his throat and says,
I think you should go up now. Come here and...
He slaps my shoulder before mounting up. He is small and dark on the back of the red stallion. Already, his hands work ceaselessly on the reins to keep the horse in place. The motion twists the bit in the horse's mouth. I watch his head rocking to and fro. It's not how I would have done it, but I'm not up there. I want to tell my father to mind how the stallion spooks to the right, how I think he sees better out of his left eye, but instead I say,
"See you when it's over."
We nod to each other like strangers. The goodbye unpracticed and uncomfortable. I am watching the race from the cliffs when a grey Ishka horse seizes my father by his arm and then his chest. For one moment, the waves do not attack the shore and the gulls above us do not flap and the gritty air in my lungs doesn't escape. Then the grey water horse tears my father from his uneasy place on the back of the red stallion. The grey cannot keep its ragged grip on my father's chest, and so my father falls to the sand, already ruined before the hooves get to him. He was in second place, so it takes a long minute before the rest of the horses have passed over the top of his body and I can see it again. By then, he is a long, black and scarlet smear, half submerged in the frothy tide. The red stallion circles, halfway to a hungry creature of the sea, but he does as I asked. He does not eat the thing that was my father. Instead, the stallion climbs back into the water. Nothing is as red as the sea that day. I don't think often on my father's body strung out through the reddening surf. Instead, I remember him as he was before the race, afraid. I won't make the same mistake.
Chapter 1. Puck. People say my brothers would be lost without me, but really, I'd be lost without them. Usually, if you ask someone on the island where they come from, they say something like, round about Skarmouth, or backside of Thisbe, the hard side, or stone's throw from Tola. But not me. I remember being small, clutching my father's lined hand, and some wind-beaten old farmer who looked like he'd been dug out of the sod, asking, "Where you from, girl?" I answered, in a voice too loud for my tiny freckled self, "The Connolly house." He said, "What's that now?" And I replied back, "Where we Connollys live, because I'm one." And then, I am still a bit embarrassed about this part of it, as it speaks to a black part of my character, I added, "And you're not." That's just the way things are. There are the Connollys, and then there's the rest of the world. Though the rest of the world, when you live on Thisbe, is not very large. Before last fall, it was always this. Me, my younger brother Finn, my older brother Gabe, and our parents. We were a pretty quiet family altogether. Finn was always putting things together and taking them back apart and saving any spare parts in a box under his bed. Gabe wasn't a huge conversationalist either. 6 years older than me, he saved his energy for growing. He was 6 feet tall by the age of 13. Our dad played the tin whistle, when he was home, and our mother performed the miracle of the loaves and fishes every evening, though I didn't realise what a miracle it was until she wasn't around. It wasn't that we were unfriendly with the rest of the island, we were just friendlier with ourselves. Being a Connolly came first. That was the only rule. You could hurt all the feelings you liked, so long as you weren't hurting the feelings of a Connolly. It's midway through October now. Like all autumn days on the island, it begins cold, but warms and gains colour as the sun rises. I get a curry comb and a brush, and I knock the dust out of Dove's dun hide until my fingers warm up. By the time I saddle her up, she's clean and I'm grubby. She is my mare and my best friend, and I keep waiting for something bad to happen to her because I love her too much. As I pull up her girth, Dove pushes her nose into my side, just shy of a nip, and pulls her head back quickly. She loves me too. I can't ride long. Soon I'll have to come back and help Finn make cookies for the local shops. I also paint teapots for the tourists, and since the races are coming up, I have more than enough orders backed up. After the races, there'll be no more visitors from the mainland until spring. The ocean is just too uncertain a thing when it's cold. Gabe will be out all day, working at the Skarmouth Hotel, getting the rooms ready for the race spectators. When you're an orphan on Thisbe, it's hard work making ends meet. I didn't actually realise there wasn't much to the island until a few years ago, when I started reading magazines. It doesn't feel it to me, but Thisbe's tiny. 4,000 people on a rocky crag jutting from the sea, hours from the mainland. It's all cliffs, and horses, and sheep, and one-track roads, winding past treeless fields to Skarmouth, the largest town on the island. The truth is, until you know any different, the island is enough. Actually, I know different, and it's still enough. So I am up and riding, my toes cold in my scruffy paddock boots, and Finn is sitting in the Morris in the drive, carefully applying black tape to a rip in the passenger seat. The rip was a gift from Puffin, the barn cat. At least Finn has now learned to never leave the windows rolled down. He's pretending to look annoyed with the repairs, but I can tell that he is actually cheerful to be doing it. It is against Finn's code to reveal too much happiness. When he sees me riding Dove, Finn gives me a funny look. Once upon a time, before last year, that funny look would have changed into a sly smile, and then he would have gunned the engine and we would have raced. Me on Dove, him in the car, though he was technically too young to drive. A lot too young. It didn't matter, though. Who was going to stop us? So he would race, me through fields, him on the roads. First to the beach, had to make the other's bed for a week. But we haven't raced for nearly a year. Not since my parents died on the boat. I turn Dove away, making little circles in the side yard. She's eager and too brisk to concentrate this morning, and I'm too cold to make her soft and round on the bit. She wants to gallop. I hear the Morris's engine rev. I turn in time to see the car go tearing down the lane, accompanied by a puff of ill-advised exhaust. I hear Finn's whoop a moment later. He pokes his head out the window, face pale under his dusty hair, smiling a grin that shows every tooth he has. "Are you waiting for an invitation?" he calls. Then he retreats back into the cab, and the engine revs high as he shifts gears. "Oh, you're on!" I tell him, though he is far, far out of earshot. Dove's ears swivel back toward me, and then prick toward the road, quivering. It is a wild, cool morning, and she barely needs to be asked. I press my calves into her sides and cluck my tongue. Dove leaps into action, hooves digging up half circles of dirt behind her, and we tear after Finn. Finn's path is no mystery. He has to follow the roads, and there's only the main one, heading into Skarmouth past our house. It's not the straightest way, though. It winds around patchwork fields, protected by stone walls and hedges. There's no sense following his serpentine progress.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.